Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Canisius Education Fair 2021. It's an honor for me, Emmanuel Agnil Putrawanadi, to host you in this wonderful event. We will hear the presentation from the Embassy of Switzerland in Indonesia that will be brought by Ms. Desak Putusinta Suryani and also Ms. Nina Bianchi as the officers at Political and Economical Division. Without further ado, to Ms. Sinta, the stage is yours.
Terima kasih Otnil untuk perkenalannya. Selamat siang Bapak Ibu Guru, Bapak Ibu Orang Tua, dan adik-adik sekalian. Perkenalkan saya Sinta dari Kedutaan Besar Swiss di Indonesia. Hari ini kami akan memperkenalkan mengenai Swiss dan juga sistem pendidikannya di sana. Sebelumnya juga kami senang sekali bisa ikut di Canisius Virtual Education Fair di tahun ini, dan ini merupakan yang pertama kali bagi Kedutaan Swiss untuk berpartisipasi di sini. Saya tidak sendiri hari ini, saya akan ditemani oleh rekan saya, yaitu Nina. Nina, please introduce yourself.
Hello, good afternoon everybody. So my name is Nina, I also work at the Swiss Embassy and I come from Switzerland, so I studied there as well. So today I'll try and share a bit of my experience studying in Switzerland. Thank you, Sinta.
Okay. Jadi saya akan memulai presentasi ini, izinkan saya untuk share screen saya. Ya, jadi ketika kalau kita ngomongin mengenai Swiss nih, biasanya ada banyak hal yang langsung muncul di pikiran kita ya. Kalau buat yang suka olahraga, pastinya familiar sekali sama Roger Federer, petenis profesional dari Swiss, yang sudah berkali-kali memenangkan Grand Slam dan kompetisi tenis lainnya. Lalu juga pastinya kalau berbicara mengenai Swiss, itu tentunya tidak lepas dari coklat. Ada fun fact juga bahwa orang-orang di Swiss itu mereka mengkonsumsi coklat itu sekitar 12 kilo per tahunnya. Jadi Swiss dan coklat itu tidak dapat terpisahkan ya. Lalu mungkin buat Bapak Ibu familiar juga Swiss itu dengan jam tangan, khususnya jam tangan mewah. Swiss itu juga merupakan salah satu produsen jam tangan, khususnya jam tangan mewah terbesar di dunia. Swiss sendiri itu terletak di jantungnya benua Eropa. Luasnya Swiss itu sendiri 41.000 km persegi. Jadi kalau dibandingkan antara Swiss dengan Indonesia, itu Indonesia sendiri itu jauh lebih luas daripada Swiss. Indonesia itu kurang lebih 40 kalinya luas dari Swiss kalau berdasarkan luas area. Swiss itu ibu kotanya itu namanya Bern, itu pusat pemerintahannya di sana. Jumlah penduduk yang ada di Swiss itu totalnya ada 8 juta jiwa, dan sistem pemerintahannya itu adalah kanton. Itu kalau di Indonesia mungkin kurang lebih seperti provinsi, ada kurang lebih ada 26 kanton yang ada di Swiss. Di Swiss itu juga ada 4 bahasa nasional. Ada Jerman yang paling banyak digunakan, yaitu sekitar 63%. Ada bahasa Prancis 23%, bahasa Itali 8%, dan juga bahasa Romansh 0,5%. Bahasa Romansh ini kaitannya atau akarnya sangat kuat dengan bahasa Latin. Nah, kenapa sih banyak orang atau banyak yang memilih untuk memilih tinggal di Swiss, baik itu untuk bekerja ataupun untuk studi di Swiss? Ada beberapa alasan biasanya. Yang pertama itu adalah safety and stability. Seperti yang kita tahu, Swiss adalah negara netral. Swiss juga dari segi politik dan ekonomi itu stabil. Dan juga dari segi misalnya tingkat kriminalitas itu rendah, jadi sangat aman untuk ditinggali. Lalu juga di Swiss sangat terkenal dengan kualitas hidupnya yang sangat baik. Kita juga sering mendengar bahwa Swiss itu terkenal dengan alamnya yang hijau, yang indah, yang bersih, dan juga itu terbukti dengan kualitas udara di Swiss yang memang sangat baik, dan juga kualitas sistem sanitasi airnya pun demikian baik juga. Selain itu, Swiss juga memiliki international outlook. Sebagaimana yang terlihat di slide yang sekarang ada, Swiss itu adalah rumah dari banyak perusahaan-perusahaan besar dunia, baik itu perusahaan yang memang berasal dari Swiss ataupun perusahaan-perusahaan multinasional lainnya. Selain itu, Swiss juga merupakan markas dari banyak organisasi internasional dunia. Kita tahu ada PBB, terus juga di sini ada di Swiss ada markasnya dari International Olympic Committee, Olimpiade yang baru saja selesai. Lalu yang bagi yang suka sepak bola ada juga FIFA di sana, lalu juga markas besar Palmeiras tentunya dan juga CERN atau the European Organization for Nuclear Research. Selain itu, karena terletak di jantungnya benua Eropa dan juga berbatasan dengan negara-negara lain misalnya Jerman, Prancis dan juga Italia, sangat banyak pengalaman-pengalaman multicultural yang ada di Swiss. Selanjutnya, ini trivia yang lain, selain yang tiga gambar yang di depan tadi. Kira-kira apa sih kaitan antara tiga gambar yang ada di layar saat ini? Ada yang pertama itu gambar hook and loop. Bahasa Indonesia mungkin kita sering, apa ya, klep mungkin ya, yang sering kita gunakan di pakaian, di tas, atau barang-barang yang sehari-hari. Lalu ada sikat gigi elektrik dan juga ada www atau browser yang sangat familiar dengan kehidupan kita sekarang yang semakin virtual ya. Kalau bisa menebak, pastinya tebakannya itu tentunya ketiga ini berkaitan dengan Swiss dan memang benar ketiga barang ini ditemukan dan juga dikembangkan di Swiss. Jadi hook and loop ini ditemukan oleh seorang insinyur dari Swiss di tahun sekitar 50-an, lalu juga sikat gigi elektrik itu juga ditemukan oleh seorang dokter yang ada di Swiss di tahun 40-an. Itu ya, jadi antara makan coklat juga iya, tapi menjaga kebersihan gigi juga iya. Jadi sikat gigi elektrik ditemukan di Swiss dan kemudian dipasarkan ke seluruh dunia. Lalu dari sistem World Wide Web ini juga ditemukan oleh seorang peneliti yang ketika itu bekerja untuk European Organization for Nuclear Research tadi. Lalu kenapa sih di Swiss itu banyak sekali penemuan-penemuan seperti tadi yang kita di slide sebelumnya atau ada banyak-banyak penemuan yang lain? Di Swiss itu sendiri mereka sangat menaruh perhatian besar kepada riset dan development. Budget yang besar itu dikeluarkan sangat lumayan besar, terutama dari sektor swasta di bidang riset dan development dan juga dikeluarkan oleh pihak universitas. Selain itu, Swiss juga termasuk di antara negara-negara yang punya budget negara yang cukup besar di bidang riset dan development. Maka dari itu tidak heran bahwa Swiss menduduki peringkat yang cukup tinggi di bidang inovasi, di bidang competitiveness, dan juga banyak sekali doktor ataupun peneliti-peneliti yang melanjutkan studi mereka itu di Swiss. Dan berbicara mengenai inovasi, Swiss juga merupakan negara yang punya mendaftarkan hak paten mereka itu salah satu yang paling banyak di dunia. Lalu bagaimana mengenai higher education atau pendidikan tinggi di Swiss? Jadi di slide ini ada beberapa ranking dari beberapa kampus yang ada di Swiss. Sebagian besar itu memiliki ranking yang cukup baik di tingkat internasional. Misalnya saja EPFL yang ada di Lausanne itu menduduki ranking 14 di QS ranking, dan juga ETH Zurich itu menduduki ranking 8 di QS ranking. Selain itu juga di kampus-kampus di Swiss itu cukup sangat welcome dengan mahasiswa-mahasiswa internasional, dan juga iklim pendidikan yang ada di Swiss itu tentunya dikelilingi oleh peneliti ataupun pengajar-pengajar yang excellent dalam bidangnya masing-masing. Di sini ada foto dari patungnya Albert Einstein di kota Bern. Jadi Albert Einstein memang seorang Jerman, tapi beliau lama studi dan belajar di Swiss, dan juga kita kenal teori relativitas Albert Einstein dengan EMC kuadratnya itu ditemukan ketika dia tinggal di Swiss, tepatnya di kota Bern. Lanjut mengenai tipe-tipe kampus yang ada di universitas yang ada di Swiss, ada tiga tipe universitas yang ada. Yang pertama adalah traditional universities, itu biasanya memang menekankan di riset dan juga pengajaran seperti universitas pada umumnya. Tipe pertama ini terdiri dari 10 cantonal universities atau kurang lebih seperti kampus universitas negeri dan juga 2 institut teknologi. Yang kedua adalah Swiss University of Applied Science and Arts. Jadi sesuai namanya yang Applied Science and Arts, jadi kampus-kampus ini banyak menekankan pada praktek kerja nyata, dan juga tentunya mereka biasanya memiliki koneksi yang cukup kuat dengan perusahaan, dengan institusi, dan juga organisasi lain yang bergerak di bidang pendidikan. Tipe universitas ketiga adalah University of Teacher Education yang khusus mendidik mereka yang memang ingin nantinya mengajar. Kurang lebih ada 20 kampus yang tergolong di dalam tipe teacher education ini. Selain tipe-tipe universitas yang ada di sini, Swiss juga tentunya sangat terkenal dengan sekolah di bidang hospitality management. Sebagian besar itu adalah sekolah swasta. Selanjutnya, mengenai study culture di Swiss akan dipresentasikan oleh rekan saya Nina. Nina, the screen is yours.
Thank you, Sinta. So since I studied myself in 2 different Swiss universities, I will try and talk to you a bit about how it is to study in Switzerland. So first of all, in terms of the kind of lectures that you can expect, in traditional universities, there are lots of lectures in big auditoriums given by the professor, and then also with often some external speakers invited to share a bit more of the practice work. Next to this, you also have smaller seminars, which allow for more discussions with other students and closer contact with the professors. These are usually groups of about 15 people. And then, especially in the universities of applied science and arts, you also have a lot more practical classes and workshops that are often organized in collaborations with companies outside of the university. Now, next to classes, you also have a very rich student life in Switzerland. There are a lot of student organizations in the different universities that you can get involved in. These range on issues from environmental awareness, social issues, entrepreneurship, political groups, and they also organize a lot of social gatherings and events. You also have offered by the university a lot of sport classes and music groups like orchestra, choirs, etc. that allow you to keep active next to class. And last but not least, there is also a very active startup scenes around a lot of several of the universities. So these are usually created by students or former students, and they are very encouraged by the university. So this is a good opportunity to either get involved in an existing startup or maybe even create your own. And in terms of professional experience, so there are about 75% of the students who do have a part-time job next to university. And this is also encouraged by the university and many companies that offer internships that are specifically targeted at students enrolled in university. And what is good to know is also that foreign students in Switzerland can work for up to 15 hours per week on a student visa. And now for something that is a little less fun, but also very important, tuition and living costs. So tuitions will vary from university and from program, depending on the city and the program that you choose. But they will be of about 7 to 30 million per semester. And then some examples of living costs. A student room for a month, again, varies a lot from city to city and from how much comfort you're looking for, but it will be about 6 to 15 million per month. And meal at a restaurant will cost you between 200,000 and 300,000. although there are a lot of discounts and cheaper options for students a lot around universities. And for a week of groceries, you should count for about 700,000, and a monthly transportation card for bus and trams around the city will cost you about 1 million. In total, the living cost for a month can be between 20 million and 28 million. Now a few words on applications and admissions. So if you want to study in Switzerland, the first step is to obviously choose a university and a program. There's a very useful website for this that is called studyprograms.ch, and you can filter there and see what the options are available. And don't forget to pay attention to the language of the program, because some are in English, but a lot of them are also in French, German, or Italian. So make sure to check that. Then you need to check the admission requirements, because Switzerland does not have a centralized admission procedure. So you need to check on the website or with the admissions office at the university to see what the requirements and deadlines are. Then, of course, you need to apply before the deadline. The academic year starts in September. Sometimes you can also start in the winter semester in February. And the application deadlines for starting in September will vary from January to April or May, depending on the program and the university. And then hopefully once you're accepted by your university, finally you need to apply for a visa with us at the Swiss Embassy. I'll give the floor back to Cinta to continue.
Thank you, Nina. Jadi tadi sudah dijelaskan mengenai gimana sih pengalaman studi di Swiss dan juga langkah-langkahnya. Lalu dari saya mau menyampaikan sedikit mengenai beasiswa yang ditawarkan oleh pemerintah Swiss. Jadi pemerintah Swiss sendiri menawarkan beasiswa Swiss Government Excellence Scholarships. Saat ini ditujukan untuk tingkat PhD dan postdoctoral dan juga beasiswa research fellowships untuk orang Indonesia khususnya yang muda ya, peneliti muda. Untuk info lebih lengkapnya bisa dilihat di link yang ada di slide. Untuk saat ini memang belum ada beasiswa dari pemerintah yang ditawarkan di tingkat bachelor dan master. Tapi untuk informasi mengenai beasiswa dari non-pemerintah bisa dicek di link-link yang ada di slide terakhir kami. Terima kasih untuk perhatiannya, dan sebelum mengakhiri presentasi kami, kami ingin menunjukkan satu video berupa testimoni dari seorang Indonesia yang pernah studi di Swiss. Saya stop dulu. Ini
Indonesia. So I would like to share with you a little bit about my story and my experience when I was living in Switzerland for about 6.5 years to complete my bachelor and my master degree from Top University.
I'm sorry, Miss Cinta, your mic is muted, so I think we cannot hear the sound of the video. Thank you, Miss.
Congratulations, Mr. Clement.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Sinta, and also Ms. Nina for the wonderful presentation. And I think we can feel the enthusiasm of the audiences here, Ms., because there are some questions that we have received here, and I think we can just proceed to the question and answer session. So for the first question, it was said that Swiss national language was is Germany, Italy, and also French. So are there any requirements for us native speakers, Indonesian speakers, to be able to learn there?
So what I can say for this is that it really depends on the program. There's a huge variety of languages depending on the program. So for the programs that are in German or in French or in Italian, but those are more rare, then you will need a certain level of French or German or Italian to be able to get admitted. But some of the programs are in English, and there you need to be able to prove a certain level of English. But then it is accessible to people who also don't speak German or French. So really it depends on the program. It's important to check on the list, what are the programs, what are the requirements, and what is accessible to whom.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Nina. Are there any addition from Ms. Sinta?
No additional information from my side.
Okay, thank you very much. So for the second question, is about what are the most popular community or maybe the most popular major in Switzerland that maybe foreign people or maybe the Switzerland people choose?
I can speak as an Indonesian that for Indonesian hospitality management are quite popular in Switzerland, but as we presented in our presentation before, so Swiss also home for scientists and also research. So actually there are a lot of opportunities in that kind of field. So Nina, would you care to add more information on this?
I think in this case it's a bit different for Swiss students or foreign students, I think for foreign students, one of the things that is most popular is the technology and science school, so the EPFL and the EPFZ in Lausanne and in Zurich. And these are also very tailored to foreign students. They have a lot of things happening in English. I think more than, for example, the law faculties or other faculties. So yeah, that would be what I would say to complete it.
Okay, thank you very much, Miss. And talking about the law faculty, do you have any suggestions for us on which university is the best for the law faculty?
I think the embassy now here is we don't represent any universities, so we would like to kindly ask you to check on the useful links that we put on our presentation and also on our virtual booth, so you can check in the study programs for the law faculty. There are some quite well-known universities in Switzerland in that respect, but Nina, what's your take on this?
I think especially on the bachelor level, a lot of universities focus on Swiss law. So universities might be more relevant for foreign students for later degrees, let's say. But yeah, there is a lot of different options. So good to check the different programs in details through the links that we gave.
Okay, thank you very much, Miss. And I think there's an interesting question right here. So what are the job prospects available after graduating in Switzerland universities, and how much is the percentage of people getting recruited when we pass or graduate from the universities in Switzerland?
I would say that in general, Swiss degrees are very recognized around the world. So having studied in Switzerland, having that on your CV is definitely a plus in terms of employability for after. In Switzerland itself, it will depend a lot on the city that you are and that you're in and the language that you can speak. I think if you speak a bit of German or French, it is a lot easier to get employed in Switzerland, but then also in Geneva and Zurich, there's a lot of things happening in English as well. And there is a demand for foreign workers, let's say, especially who have studied in Switzerland and who have this background. So yeah, it depends on the city and the background, but it is definitely a very recognized training, let's say, and the quality of the Swiss universities is very recognized in Switzerland and abroad.
Any addition from Ms. Sintamis?
Just would like to add that in Indonesia we have this Swiss Alumni Association that consists of people who previously lived and also studied in Switzerland, and there are a lot of many people in their respective fields that have studied in Switzerland that now they're excelled in their own field, for example as lecturers, as working in the companies and also startups. So I would concur with what Nina just said before.
Okay, I think it's really, really exciting to know more about Switzerland, and I believe also the audience feels the same. But unfortunately, we are heading to the end of the session, Miss. So I think, do you have any notes for the audiences, for any conclusion or maybe notes?
If you have further question or you need further information about Switzerland and study in Switzerland, we would kindly welcome you on our virtual booth. We have some useful links also posted in there, so you can also check there. Nina?
Yes, thanks for having us. I think it's great also for me to be able to share with my experience and encourage people to come study in my country. And so yeah, as Cinta said, we're available still over the next few days. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate. We're here to answer as much as we can.
Thank you very much, Ms. Nina, and also Ms. Cinta for the wonderful presentation. And for the audiences, if your questions aren't answered yet, or you have any more questions to be asked, no problem, don't worry, don't hesitate. Just visit the Switzerland virtual booth in the Canisius Education Fair at 2021. And it's all for this presentation session. I'm Emmanuel Otniel Putrawan Nadri, and also Ms. Sinta and also Ms. Nina. We are sorry if there's any inconvenience. And good afternoon. And this event is supported by